Good morning. Good morning. Okay. Now we're moving. Are you in a good mood? That's good. Welcome. Welcome to the wonderful world that is Bootstrap. By the way, it's not Twitter Bootstrap anymore, just Bootstrap. So just know that. That's good. First thing learned. Let me introduce myself first. My name is Shay Friedman. I'm founder of a company named Code Value. I do consultancy, training, write code, and eventually I also manage the web division of Code Value. And I'm Microsoft MVP for C Sharp. And I wrote the book about Iron Ruby. How many of you have heard about Iron Ruby? Okay, three. Okay, so unfortunately this is dead right now. Even the site won't come up anymore. So you can still order my book at Amazon. I figured out yesterday. I'm one day too late, but you can buy it as a prank to your friends and give them this. So please do. It's great. It's like this, 500 pages, so you can raise your screen. Yes, do that, please. Anyway, this is me. So now, if you want to contact me, my Twitter handle is ironshay, and ironshay.com, this is my blog, and if you want my email address, phone number, address, home address, bank account, I don't know, shoe size, I just come to me afterwards, I will tell you anything. You want to know and don't want to know. Okay, so now you guys. How many of you here are web developers? That kind of makes sense. How many of you have done things with Bootstrap? Cool, so I hope to teach you guys some things today. How many of you want to do things with Bootstrap? All of us. Okay, I think all of you. I will ask this again at the end. We'll see. Okay. So, we're going to talk about Bootstrap, of course. So, first thing first. What is Bootstrap? So, this is, I'm on the right track. What is Bootstrap? CSS. How many of you do CSS? Almost all of you. How many of you like doing CSS? You can raise your hand, it's not I'm not sure, okay, maybe, sometimes. How many of you feel when you're creating CSS definitions that you are repeating yourself every single time? Yeah, that's a big problem. And CSS, I really like CSS. It's a really nice language, and think about it, it's probably one of the only languages that do actually what they are supposed to do. Think about it. CSS should define what the website looks like. And this is exactly what CSS is doing. Nothing more. But this is exactly what it was supposed to do. Which is great. This is why I like CSS. It's very simple, yet very powerful. But because it's so simple, it gets a bit complicated to maintain after a while. Because it's great for very small sites. Once your website becomes very big with a lot of definitions, maintaining it becomes quite a, how you call it, bitch. Yeah. So yeah, it's not very nice, not very nice to maintain. So what we were waiting for was some kind of framework that take away all the repetitive stuff and make it much more easier to use. And we can just use the framework and forget about everything else. Think about CSS, and I'm sure you have done this. How many of you are familiar with the Dash WebKit Dash CSS applications? How many of you think this is the worst thing in humanity history ever? How someone, a human being, can think about something like that and thinks it's a good idea? Yeah, we'll do that. And everyone else doing it as well. Dash MS, dash O, dash whatever. You can invent your own dash and go on with it. Everyone is cool with it. Everyone likes that. So why not? So all of this stuff kind of irritating. And if we can have something that does that for us and supports browsers, old browsers, not that old, like IE6 and stuff, we can and we can take advantage of that. I can see why not. So Twitter Bootstrap is exactly about that. It's a framework, a CSS framework, and we'll see that it has some JavaScript there, but mainly CSS framework that is supposed to take all this repetitive stuff, all this thinking of how to support all browser, how to support responsive design, to support, for example, mobiles, tablets, and web and desktop at the same design. How to do all of that? It takes away this this role from us, does that, and now we're free from this responsibility. We can do the actual application that we were supposed to do. So this is Bootstrap. Why was it called Twitter Bootstrap? Because two guys from Twitter did that, and at one point of time, I have no idea why, they stopped calling themselves Twitter Bootstrap. And if you go to the About page in the Bootstrap website, you will see it says Twitter, but you will not find it anywhere else. So it's Bootstrap now, just Bootstrap. Now, this is not the only framework out there. There is Bootstrap, and there is another one called Foundation from Zurb, that's the name of the company. And they are almost identical. Like, let me show you how identical they are. If you go to the website, this is the Bootstrap website. And let's go to the foundation. Zurb.com. So this is how it looks like. And let's go to the documentations. I don't know, CSS. Now let's do that. Put that here and put that here. And you see that they have this thing here and it looks very, very similar. So what I'm trying to tell you, they're all doing the same, so just pick the one that makes sense to you. They're almost the same. They kind of have different components eventually, but the basics are very, very similar. So they're both kind of popular. So just know that there is more than just Bootstrap. Okay, so this is what. Now why? So I was talking about the why, and let me just say one disadvantage of that. And some people see this as a disadvantage. I'm not sure yet if it's really a disadvantage. When you start working with Bootstrap, you start seeing websites on the internet and that use Bootstrap as well, and then you're like, oh, this is using Bootstrap, and then, oh, this uses Bootstrap as well. And then you figure out that half the internet is using Bootstrap, and they all look the same. Now, I don't think it's a bad idea that we all have some unified UI and UX for our websites, because it's better for our users. But people do like to be exceptional and different, and you can do that with Bootstrap. Bootstrap is not taking over everything, but it is. If you go with what Bootstrap gives you, it will make your site look very much like other websites. So some people look at it as a disadvantage. I say it as an advantage, actually. And again, Bootstrap, you do not have to work with Bootstrap to and make it own your site. You are the owner of the site, okay? So you can use Bootstrap wherever you want to use Bootstrap, okay? And we will see the different parts of Bootstrap. So you can see what you want and work only with what you need and not just everything that it gives you, because it's not a law. I know you people here in the British Islands, that you like to law. I come from the Middle East where the law is a recommendation. And so I'm kidding, it's not really. It's not that chaotic. A bit, but never. Okay, so this is why. So let's start talking about the parts of Bootstrap. And let me just show you what we're gonna see, what we're gonna do. So this is what I have now. I have this amazing, amazing product that I want everybody to download. And I have the description here, and I have people say stuff about my product, like my dad says it's the best product ever created, and my mom says that you must have it. And there are code samples. This is great. This is whatever you want to do. And amazing, and this is a comparison table between my, that does everything, and the other products that does nothing. And you can download it, and this is the guy behind him. This is me and my sister's dog, Joy. She's a great coder. A lot of design sense. Anyway, I don't know why, but this website is not going very well. People don't download my product, and I don't know why. So I decided to improve that with Bootstrap. So what we're going to end after this session, we are going to end with this thing, which looks much more professional, with big download now here that you click and you get this, which looks much more professional. And then you can see and admire the website, and because of that you will download the amazing product. So this is what we're going to do. So let's begin. All with Bootstrap, by the way. So the first part of Bootstrap is the CSS. Now there are a few parts of these CSS, and the first one, which I think made Twitter Bootstrap pretty popular, is the grid system. Now, grid. When we think about grid, we think about tables, right? Tables are great. They're awesome. I was doing layouts with tables about 15, 16 years ago. It was great. It was a table. And then I had, inside the table, I had another table. Inside the table, I had another table. And then another table, and another table. And then when I saw that I had four nested tables, I said, OK, let's add another 10 nested tables. So I ended up with like a gazillion tables, one in the other, and it was great. And I had an animated GIF under construction. It was awesome. But times passed by, and tables are not cool anymore. I don't know why. It was so fun. They actually named it. You can Google it or Wikipedia it. It's called Table Hell, really, because of all these nested tables. So if they have a name for it, it's probably bad, just like diseases. If there is a name for it, it's bad. So this is the same thing. And tables are bad because it takes more time for the browser to figure out what the width should be, and then the nested tables, and the nested tables, and go on, and go on. So the website ends up very, very sluggish. So we want to prevent that. And the cool guys today, only them, by the way, they use divs, right? But divs also have their problems. So this framework, Bootstrap, gives you this idea of a grid, which, you see, it looks like a kind of a table. You have a grid system in Bootstrap. Contains, every row contains 12 boxes. So you see, these are 12 boxes. Then you can play with these boxes. So you see, this says call MD1, 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 but but you can say call MD8 and MD4. So then you have 2/3 of the width going with this column, and 1/3 goes with the other one. Now the cool thing about that is that it's responsive. What does it mean that it's responsive? That when you have a mobile phone or a tablet that is smaller, this might go one under the other. So this will take one row, and this will take the other row. And so you don't need to think about it when you're developing, but you need to figure out if it would make sense. Now you see that it says column MD, which is medium, 8. So what is medium? Twitter Bootstrap, Twitter is good, but Bootstrap is better. Medium is a size of the website, of the width of the website. Let's go to the Twitter Bootstrap. Site, and let's look. Oh, not here. I just want to show you this grid. No, it was there. Yeah, grid system. So, good. So you see there are four types of widths: large devices, which are desktops, and the container width. We will see that in a moment. Is maximum 1,170 pixels. If you're going down to something between 992 pixels and 1,200 pixels, it goes down to 970 pixels, the width of the entire site. Then it goes down to 750, and then it goes down to 100%. So you see there is this a differentiation between extra small devices, which are mobile phones, small devices, which are might be mobile phones like Galaxy Note and stuff like that. I think it's called phablets, right? Medium devices, which are probably tablets or small screens, and desktop screens. So you don't need to think about these widths, because Bootstrap have already done that for you. They have this all the data from Twitter, all the users of Twitter, so they know how to differentiate between the actual devices. So you don't need to think about it. This comes as is. And you see that then you can actually say on the grid system, I want, we saw the call MD, but you have call SM for small devices, call XS for extra small, and call LG for large. So you can say the grid system will look like this in large desktops, will look like that in smaller width screens, and so on and so forth. So you can really adjust your layout just by using CSS classes. Let's see that. So this is the grid in action. Now there is some kind of a bug with Bootstrap 3 that you see there is this horizontal scroll bar. It will go away in a few seconds. I will show you how. But you shouldn't do that. This should be inside a container, and we'll see that in the actual demo. But you see, this is called MD, MD4, MD8, MD4, 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 6, 6. So you see how you can play with that. And here, I have different definitions. This is called XS12. So for extra small devices, this part will take the entire width. And this part says call XS6 will take only half the screen. Okay. And if the screen is bigger, is medium or bigger, then this will take 2/3 of the screen, and this will take 1/3 of the screen. Let's see how we do that. Let's take it here. So now if we go with that, so you see this now changes to just one beneath the other, because it doesn't have more space. And you see here, that. So you see here, this actually takes the entire width and this only half the width. Now, one tip in Chrome, the latest version or the version before, they added emulation for devices, small devices. So you open the developer tools, F12, click escape to open this, and you see here there is emulation. Click that, I'll do that, and you see you can pick different versions of mobile phones. So if we go with Samsung Galaxy Note and emulate, so you see you should probably refresh and then you can work with that. Zooming doesn't work. And you can, and it actually tells you what is the width of the mobile phone and whatever. So you can go with the Nokia, which is the worst here, or generally, in the last few years only. So you can test that, and you can test tablets like iPad. So this is really helpful when you're designing. So just remember that it's available. Okay. So this is the grid system, and as I said, once you get used to that, to this grid system, you just don't go back. It just makes much more sense. And the greatest part here is that you don't have to use it just for the entire layout. You can use it just inside other divs, even smaller divs, just to separate the row. So you can say, I have this div, and I want it to have, I don't know, on the left part, I want the label, and then the input, and label and input. You can use the grid system for that, just inside this div. So it's a great, great thing. OK, so this is one thing. This is just that, a killer feature, in my opinion. All the rest is good, but this is a killer feature. So now that you've seen the killer feature, we can stop. No, you paid full ticket. So let's continue. In our CSS, this is the rest. And what I like about Bootstrap is this. This I can remove. Okay, so I have this now, right? So let's just go, this is the code, okay? This is the code. Very, well, let me, can you see that on the back or, yeah? Good, so this is the code. All I wanna do now is add the Bootstrap CSS. So you download it, you have it on CDNs as well, whatever that you like. I just added the CSS, that's it. Save, and let's go back here, and let me just duplicate that. So now you can see, this is how it looks now. This is how it looks with the CSS, and this is how it looks without. So I have a better looking font. The block quotes here look a bit better. There is this line here that makes them stand out. The code sample looks much better. The table still not very nice. Download, everything here is about the same, but you see that it already, just by adding the CSS, it looks better. Okay. So, let's close that, refresh, good. So now I have that. Now, CSS has some different things about it. So typography is what we've just seen. Changes the fonts, the sizes, everything kind of fits together. And it has some other stuff that, let's just go through that and see how it looks like. So the first thing, I told you that they have this bug that has this scroll bar, right? When you're using the grid system. In order to prevent that, and in order to actually work correctly with Bootstrap, we need to put all of this in a wrapper div with a class container. So you see I have this div here. behavior div, and I can add a class named contain. Okay, that's all. And now, if I refresh that, you see that I now have small margins on the site. And if we take it out and make it smaller, you will see that, you see that? It just jumps. Okay, so Bootstrap has this notion. You see these container width. When you design for Bootstrap, you have four different container widths that you need to think about. It's this one, 1170 pixel, this one, 970, 750, and lower than that. So you know what you're facing. You're not facing an infinite amount of widths that you need to think, wait, here I need to put the image here, or disable the image at all and not show the table. You don't think about it. You think about, okay, I have this thing here, the large devices, medium devices, small devices, and others. And that's it. So it's it becomes easier to create the actual design, because you have only four different versions or concepts. So this is what we get just by adding the container. And when you're using the container, you won't get the vertical scroll bar when you're using the grid system. Okay, so this is the best practice. Okay, so now we have the table here. We need to make all this lower part look better, because I want people to download the amazing product. So let's go to the table. And this is the table, right? So what I need to do, and you see that everything in Bootstrap is based on CSS classes, right? This is almost the only thing that you need to do when working with Bootstrap, adding CSS classes to different things. So the first thing I want to do is just add table. So this is all I did, and let's see now. Much better, just adding table. Now, most of the time we will want to make the table look a bit different, or maybe the odd lines should have a different background color. So I can add more. So there is table striped. And now, just like that, it looks like that. And now I want every time the cursor is on top of one of the rows to have some kind of a hover background color. So table hover will take care of that. So now, when I go up on the rows, it does that. So three different CSS definitions, and I'm kind of done. There is also, if you don't like this stripe idea, there is a bordered one. I like it less, so I don't use it, but you can use it as well. It's the same thing. And of course, if you want something else, just add. It's CSS. It's open. You can do whatever you want in CSS, which is for good and for bad. Whatever you want, you can do. So you can change all the defaults of Bootstrap. If you don't like the widths, for example, of the containers, and you say, I have only two widths or whatever, you can, Bootstrap is based on less, L-E-S-S, which is a language written on top of CSS that adds some capabilities like variables and mixins and functions for CSS, and it's compiled to CSS eventually. So what Twitter Bootstrap has is this variables file that you can just change. So you can change all the default colors, you can change the widths, you can change almost everything about Bootstrap. And of course, because it's CSS, you can override everything that they do for your needs. So if you don't like most of the things and just like part of it, just override whatever you want or remove whatever you don't need, and still use Bootstrap just for what it gives you. So we took care of the table. Now let's take care of the form, because this is the most important part, right? I want people to go and download my amazing product. So let's go here. This is the download form. So this is a bit different because most of the time people might use tables or might use other stuff. And here you put divs inside divs inside divs. It kind of looks like a div hell. And I'm sure in 10 years someone will stand here and talk to you about div hell. But today it's the cool div that helps us do whatever we want. So free spirit, yo. So now we have this. This is how it looks. So we have a div, a container div for in the entire form, right? So we will add a class here. Said form horizontal. Right. This is it. And now for each input, I have this div here, which has the label inside, and then another div, which has the input. Okay, so this is how it looks like, the div, and another div for the submit button. So let's add a class here called form group. Why form group? Because this is the group for the form. It has a label and an input, so it does make sense. Let's copy that. Okay, so form group. Now we go to the label. The label also has a class. Class control label. Now, one thing I want to do, because right now it looks like that, and I want it to be your name and the input, and your email and the input. So, what I'm going to use? The grid, right? So, I can use the grid right there. So what I'm going to do in the label, with the control label, I'm going to put call sm2. Okay, so it will take just two boxes. So this is for the label. Now this div, again, I want it to take also two boxes. I don't want the input to be like the entire width of the screen. So I just want it to be the entire thing to be. One third, yes. Math inside of, in the middle of a talk, that's not a good idea. So let's do that. Class call SM2. Okay, so now both of these, the label and the input field, will take one third of the screen. And of course, the input itself. Input itself should have class and form control. Okay, so let's save that and let's see. So what we did, form horizontal for the entire thing, form group for each group of control, for each label and input control. And then label, form label, control label, and form control. Okay, this is what we did right now. And this now looks much better, right? What's not looking better is the submit button. So let's fix that. So the submit button, okay. So class equals call. What's the problem now? I don't want the submit to be here. I want the submit to be right underneath the input. So I need a way to take this and put it like two boxes to the right. So what I can do is add a div with class and call sm2, which is good, but I hate HTML elements that don't have purpose. So not good, delete. What we can do is something that is called call sm offset. So this tells it, go take two boxes to the right. And then you will take call SM2. Okay. So two small columns. And the actual button will be BTN. Okay, all the buttons are BTN. And BTN primary g- gives it a nice blue color. So if we refresh now, we have a problem. Yeah, this should probably go. No, who's behind? What did I do wrong? Call SM offset 2. What did I delete? Did I even need to delete? That's the question. Interesting. That's debugged during. Oh, no, I don't want the emulation. So let's see what happened. We have this, and we have this for horizontal. All right. What did I forget? Form group, and of course I forgot to put it here. So the class does go here, but form group should also be here. So great. Okay. So you see that the button also looks nice, and this is also something that is nice about Bootstrap. If you use it by the, with the default colors, all the colors are really nice. It's if you try to see and see what I pick for colors, some people will never see again. So yeah, this is my design skills, but this gives me superpowers because I don't need to think about it. This, look at this blue, it's so nice, and then you hover it and it's like it's slightly darker blue. It's so good. So people say, "Wow, you chose good colors," and I'm like, "Yes, I'm the man." Okay, so yeah, so you get colors, and you will see more colors after that during the presentation. And really, the colors they come from real research. Okay, they don't just invent the colors. They have UX designers in Twitter, and they took the idea of the color scheme from them. So it's not just someone who invented the colors like me, because then it wouldn't end well. So this is another advantage. Now, last but not least, I like these photos, but they're very square. So let's make them pop a bit more. Let's make them circles. So I'm going here to image and class image circle. Okay. And this is all I need to do in order to have this. Much better. So you see how it looks like now. Much, much better than it used to. And only by putting CSS classes. That's all I needed to do. Which is us. Just us. So we actually saw all of these. Moving forward to components. Now, components are CSS only components, like HTML plus CSS. No JavaScript involved yet. And there are tons of components. You see all these components, and there are even more. So it's great. You just go to the components part of the Bootstrap documentation, and it's really the best documentation that I've ever seen. They have everything there. Everything that you need in like few lines. Really, great documentation, and it's not something that you see every day, especially in open source projects. So it's great. Now, they have different components. I will show you all six of them. And they even have a component called Jumbotron. Enough said. Isn't there a transformer named Jumbotron? It's crazy. since I saw this component, every side that I have, I put the jumbotron div. Just because it's called a jumbotron. let's see the first thing about components. I just wanted to show you here. When you use Bootstrap, you have these life icons. These are all the icons, and there are a bunch of them. Pretty, I think about 100 or even more. These are all coming from a font. Okay, it loads a font, and so you can actually put colors on them and make them bigger or smaller, so you can use them like that. And what I like about these, that they have almost everything that you always need, the small icons. You have this plus, minus, edit, user, volume up, volume down. Really, everything that you need is here, so you don't need to search for it. And if I don't need to search for it, it just reduces the time it takes me to do stuff. And then I can go to the pub earlier, so win-win. So let's go through the components. Let's improve our our application. Now, what I need now in my application is some navigation bar, because every successful application, every successful download page for an application has a navigation bar, even if you don't need that. So I need it here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go here, and I'm going to take this from here because it's too much code to write. And let's put it right there. So let's go through that. So this is nav. Nav is one of the new HTML elements in HTML5. It doesn't really have to be the nav element. It can be a div or whatever. But nav, if you're using HTML5, use that. And again, it has a class navbar, navbar default, navbar inverse. We'll see that in a second what that means. Then I have the header. Okay, it says my awesome product. This is the brand. And then I have this links. Okay, so I have the UL, nav navbar, nav. This is the actual navigation. And list item, which is the link to the description, and another list item what people say, and all of that. If I save it now again, no JavaScript at all, just HTML and CSS. If I refresh the page, see just there, and pretty much all you need. Now, this is the black one. You can go, you see the number inverse, this is, I added that. It comes with Bootstrap, but I just, without that, it looks like that. And I like the black more. I think it looks more professional for my product. So I use the black one, but again, you can choose either that or the other one, or again, give your designer to pick the colors for you, not me. Now, a small trick. A lot of sites, because you see that there is some kind of margin on the site, and a lot of sites you see today, they have this navigation bar that goes all the way, and then the rest underneath it. So the trick here is to split it into two containers. So you put the navbar into a single container, and let's go to the end. This is the end of the nav. Just close the first container and then open up another one. If I go and refresh, everything looks about the same, maybe a bit more margin there. But now what I can do, I can add, I can wrap this div, the navigation div, with another div and build a background to that. So then I will have a div that goes all the way. So if I do something like that, style, background. Let's see. I'll just for the sake of it. I told you I should never pick colors. Div does all the work, and it looks great. I forgot what I wanted to say. you can actually remove all the margins from the top, just CSS, so you can do that. And of course, play with the margins underneath the navbar. So it's all CSS play. Just remember that in order to actually have something that goes all the way, all the width, without the container limitations, just put a wrapper around the container, and then you're done. Okay. Oh, I know what I wanted to say. This, never do that, okay? I'm the speaker, so I'm allowed. But I'm also allowed to never do that, okay? Never put style inside your elements. Just put a class and do it in a different file. Put the CSS there. This is a very, very bad practice. Okay. You know what happens when you do that? Huh? Ooh, what? Exactly. You've been to my presentation yesterday?
Yes.
Okay, so yes. When you do that, a kitten dies. So don't do that. Always remember that when you do that, think about this poor little kitten. Who killed the kitten?
You.
I? Yes, I know, but it's for a good purpose. Because I saved like 60 different kittens, so it's good. but yeah, I feel sad inside. Okay, so let's continue. Yes, so now every time that I talk to our UX people, they say, well, you need the call to action pretty soon on your site. So right now people come here and they don't understand that they need to download this amazing product. They just see and they say, okay, that's an amazing product, because these people say it's an amazing product. But they don't know what to do. So I need a call for action. So I want the call for action to stand out. So for that, I have something that is called an alert box. So I will put it here. I'll just create, again, a div and a class, and the class says alert, and I want the alert to be alert info, and there is an alert error, an alert warning. Info is good because people will not be like, ooh, I don't know what to do now, so it looks better. I will take this is my Grid application, download it now, and put it here. So now, like that. This is great, because now people come here and see and they say, oh, this color is so nice. I will go and download it now. It goes perfectly with the yellow. Now, another cool thing, I want it to be in the middle. Now, what you probably would do usually, you will go and create a class, call it center or something, or even go and kill a kitten, because we will write style text align center. So we don't want to do either. What we want to do is do text center, something that Bootstrap just gives you, and it will just center that. And what it does underneath is just text align center, but I don't need to write it myself. Great. So. Next thing, what now is bad with my site is people see that, and I want them to feel a connection to me, to this product. And I will do that by putting my face up there. So it might create a connection, or people would run away. But it will create some emotional reaction, which is good. So let's take this, let's take this and put it up, not that up, yes, just before what people say. Now, again, I want it to stand out. So I'm going to use another component called panel. So I'm going to create, again, a div. And you know what? I'll just copy that. Again, too much. Div. OK. So I have this panel. Panel default, again, this is how the colors are, panel heading, and the title. So the title is who's behind this awesome product. You see the class here is for H2, right? So this is the title, and this is the actual panel content. And the content is these. Great, so let's remove that. What did I do? Again, just it's a component. It's called a component. It's just a div with a class named panel. The panel has a heading and a content. That's it. Save, and now it will look like that. OK, so now people come here. You see, they say, OK, I need to download. Oh, who is this ugly person? Oh, this is a cool dog. I will download it. So this is how they go and do stuff. And now they say, OK, where am I going to download that? So they scroll down, they see everything, and they say, oh, download. So I'm coming here to the name, and I would, what should I write here? This is my name, or this is an email. I don't know what an email is. Oh, so I hope they know. But anyway, I want to help them. And helping the users with visual aids, always good. So let's go to the download form. This is, again, the download form. Let's make it a bit better. OK, so I have this div here of the input, right? So what I want to do, I want to add something to that. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to add here input group. Input groups says that it means, oh, it's too far. It means that the input there will have some kind of an add-on to that. And you will understand in a second what that means. So this is my input. I'm not going to touch it. OK, just my input. But I'm going to add, before that, a span with a class named input group add-on. And this span will have another span that has a class, and here I'm going to use the glyph icons. So glyph icon dash user. Good. And let's save that. And now, let's do that so you all can see. So you see there is this person right here. So if I didn't know that it was my name, so I see the person and say, oh, that's me. So, so yes. And now I want to do the same for email. So this is the email. Again, input group and span class. Input group add-on. Span and right. I don't need an icon now. I just need that, right? So you see, you don't need, or you don't, you're not, you don't have to put icons there. You can just put spring. So you can actually write something that will help your user, like please write here something yada yada yada. So you don't have to put icons, but this is really nice. It makes the form pop out. And last but not least, let's add an icon to the submit button. And what I want in the submit button, that if people got here and they're like, should I download? Should I write my details? I will click submit. So let's make this emotional reaction. So again, I have this input here. So I'm going to change it to a button. And the class is the same, because inputs are very hard to style, so buttons are much easier. So I have this button here, and inside the button, I'm going to add an I, a span, sorry, with a class, life icon dash heart. You see where this is going, right? Yeah, I didn't need to do that. Well, let's see how that looks. Okay, so you know what? Let's put it there. So, well, they don't even know they need to click on that. Never mind. they write everything and they say, well, what should I do now? Oh, there is a heart. Let's click it. And next thing they know, they have my application. Great. So these are components, okay? And how are we on time? Okay, we have time. So there are much more components there, okay? You see all of these. There are a lot of things that you need pagination and badges like these, and really a lot of stuff that you can just use. And the cool thing about these, that you really need all of them. Okay, every time that you create an application, you need a pagination, you need a navbar, you need this input group, you need all the buttons, you need all of this. So it's really nice, and it's just there. So you, once you get to know all of the things that there are in Bootstrap, you can just, you say, oh, okay, I will use that. Oh, okay, I will use that. So this is the great thing. There are so many things, but they are useful. It's not just like all the component that you buy, third-party components that have a lot of stuff, and you usually end up using the grid, and that's it. Here you really need all of these. At least from my experience, they all become handy once in a while. So this is component. Now, the next thing is the JavaScript components. And this is the step brother of Bootstrap, because it's a part of Bootstrap, but you don't have to use it. And if you want to use it, you need the JavaScript file. So once you download Bootstrap, in order to use this, you need to add this script, of Bootstrap, okay? Because otherwise nothing will work. Okay, so this is the first thing. But what's cool about these components, at least for the basic ones, is that you don't need JavaScript anymore. You do everything via data attributes on the actual elements, so you don't need to write JavaScript. You can control everything via JavaScript, but you don't have to. So it makes it much easier. For example, we have in our company, we have people who know Bootstrap, but they are not developers. So they can still use most of this stuff without writing a single line of code. So they can create all the feeling of the website, and the code is done by developers. So it's something that is very, very nice and very appealing to big projects, because then you have the designers. The designers can design and write Photoshop, do their Photoshop magic, whatever they do. I don't know. They're designers. I don't know what they do. But they produce PSDs. And then they give them to something we call HTML craftsmen, and these people, they know HTML and CSS. They don't know JavaScript or in the bare minimum. And they go ahead and use Bootstrap and create the entire site, how it looks like and how it behaves in a very basic way. And then the developer kicks in and starts filling up the gaps. So it's very good for the flow of big projects. So, for the components, let's add a component. to the application. Okay, so what I want now, I want the download to be in a pop-up. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to here, and I'm going, again, it's a lot of code, so it looks worse than it what it is, okay? So let's go through all of that. So this is my div. It says, it's a wrapper div, says this is the model dialog, okay? And now I have, I forgot one line that might hurt. Okay, so yes, I have the wrapper div, and it says the class is model, so this is a model dialog, and fade is the animation. I have different kinds of animations, and this is how I say which animation I want to use. So fade is the one. This is the idea, and we will see where we use it in a second. Now I have the wrapper model dialog. This is where everything goes in. Then the content. Again, someone says div hell. No? Okay, good. But this is where the actual content goes to. So this is the header. Okay, so I have the header. Inside the header, I have a button. And the button say data-dismiss model. This says to Bootstrap, when this is clicked, if there is a model dialog open somewhere, close it. So this is what it means, because only one model dialog can be opened in a single time. So this is what it says, and you can have it in different places. If you want other buttons to do that, an image, a link, whatever, just data-dismiss model. And this is, you know what it is? This is the X for closing. And this is the model title. Okay, so this is just the header. Then we have the body. Okay, and the body have the form. Okay, this is the form that we created. It's the same one. And form. And eventually we have the footer where the buttons go. So we have the close button. And again, here again, we have the data-dismiss model statement. And this is the button that says download with our heart. Okay, very important. Now, what are we missing? A way to open that, right? So, we can now remove this part, right? I don't need the download part anymore because I have it in the model, but I do want the people to know what to do. So what am I missing? Now, this is how it looks like. I need a place that says download. So of course, what I did not use, and I said that in every application preview I have this, I want to use a Jumbotron. I need this Jumbotron. So let's put it right underneath here. I create a div class Jumbotron. So much fun. Can say Jumbotron all day long. Jumbotron. Never get enough. Text center. When I say Jumbotron, I cannot do anything else. So this is not good. Okay, so now I want to put a button. So let's put a button. And with a class, so we saw the classes of buttons. So we have BTN primary. And also, I'm going to put BTN LG, which means the button is going to be large. And of course, let's say download now. Now, this doesn't actually say what we want to do. It will not open anything. So again, everything is done via the attributes. So data toggle equals model. This means that I want to open the model dialog. And now we don't know which model dialog. So data target this is the ID. So the ID was the download dialog. This is the ID of the container of the model dialog. So I'm pretty much done, looks like. Reload. So we have the jumbotron. Now, why it's called a jumbotron? It's because it's jumbo and tron. No, it's big. It actually has another name. It's called also the hero zone. I'm not kidding you. The hero zone. This is like the too much hero zone. What? Jumbotron is geeky enough. The idea here, you see it in a lot of places, in a lot of sites, that you have like a big part when you enter the site that tells you this is what we do, and maybe it has a carousel inside or something like that. So you see it in a lot of places, and it has a name, the hero zone, and they call it the jumbotron. So this is why it's big, and whenever there is text inside that, you will, the text will be like crazy big, okay? Very, very big, because then you say, okay, this is my amazing product. So the user cannot overlook that. They say, okay, this is your amazing product. Okay, I will continue reading. So what they do now, they will get into my site. They will see, okay, this is a great application, download. Okay, I will do what I said. So download that, I will click that. So they click here and nothing happens. That's great. That's not what I want. So what happened? Yes, I need to put this here. Okay, so yes. So now this works and you see everything here and they put everything and there is this heart here, everything is good. And I can even continue because now they say, oh, I don't want to download here. Now I will see, oh, these are the people behind it. The people, there is a dog here. So I'm gonna do whatever UX designer will tell you to do, put the download link everywhere. So every couple of lines, good. So good, so now you cannot miss it. Like, okay, download now. No, not convinced yet. Okay, down. Okay, good. So, this is a great website. Maybe one of the best ever created. Let me show you, because there is more time, to show you something more. It's a small thing, but still very useful. And it is a tooltip. So, now we have these tooltips here. Or we don't have any tooltips here, which is good. But when I put tooltips, let's go to the, now it's, okay, image. I can go and say, instead of, it can go title, and say title equals, and title equals I'm the dog. Okay. But this, when you go here, and it looks old, right? The yellow. So I want a real tooltip. So this is something different. So this is what I want to show you. Let me just take it from here. Okay, so instead of title, Sammy is another dog, not from here. I'm a doggy. So, data toggle, tooltip, okay? Again, no JavaScript involved. Data dash placement, top, it can be top, bottom, left, or right, and the title itself. Let's take the same here. Okay, now, if we go and try to see that, it doesn't work. Now, I spent quite a time in the first time I did that, Because it's like, well, you said no JavaScript is involved. I don't need to write JavaScript. But I don't know why. Here you need to write JavaScript just to make this work. So you need one line of code, but you still need that. So when it goes up, let's add a script here. So all you need to do is just say, find all the elements that have data toggle tooltip and just tooltip them. Okay? And this will make it work. Now, I think that it might be extra work that they need to do when there is a tooltip. So they don't want to do that if they don't need to. But I have no idea. It doesn't work as is. Now, when I do that, so you see, it looks much better. And you can, of course, change the CSS of that and make it pop, make it bigger, make it not black, or whatever. So this is the tooltip. And of course, there are much more. If we go here, JavaScript. So you see there are much more. Tabs, popovers, alerts, buttons, a lot of stuff, carousel. We all need carousels. If the name comes from an amusement park, it's probably good. So this is the carousel. So again, there are a lot of these. There are a lot of extensions, by the way, on the internet for Bootstrap. So there are more components. It probably won't be enough for something like a line of business application, because there is no grid. I see it here moving. So you will probably need more components to use, but this will give you the basic needs. It will fulfill most of your basic needs, and if it's not a line of business application, you might find everything you need inside here. So this is even better. Questions? Yes?
Does it matter what tags we use? If we, like, I've seen that if you have your input field, you can use a span to add that image. Mm-hmm. Does it have to be a span, or can it be?
No, it can be almost anything. they don't really care. But you probably would want to, because it uses span, so it doesn't, if you use div, it goes, it takes the entire row. So
it doesn't affect the style.
No, it doesn't matter. Most of the things work with any tag. One question.
If you wanted to change the overall course, if you had a designer that came with the course, how easy is that to?
They have a file, and I'm not sure I have it. I don't want to spend the time to find it, but they have one file with all the variables. So you just go and change the colors. Yeah. That's it. Yes?
I've seen that if you want to do a row span, equivalent of a row span across rows, that you have to, what's your class, which is, looks like double, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, doing an equivalent of row span on the grid system. I actually never needed to do that. If I remember correctly, there is some sort of a solution for that, even inside a Bootstrap itself, not like a workaround. But I will need to look it up. So just if you want to come for that. More questions? Okay, so. This is where you go to get Bootstrap. It even says get Bootstrap. This is the site, this is the documentation is there, everything is there. So we saw Bootstrap, we saw all the basics of Bootstrap. We saw that it has the CSS part that prettifies your application with or without your help. You just put it there and it just makes it pretty. And if you use the classes, it's even prettier. There is this components part, only HTML plus CSS components that There are a lot of them. Just go through the documentation. We saw just a few of them, and of course the Jumbotron. Just go through them and use whatever that you find useful for you. There are so much of them. Why not? And the JavaScript components. By the way, they are also called JavaScript plugin or extensions. I don't know which one to use, so I just call them JavaScript components. But if you see JavaScript plugins, just know that it's the same thing. So it's another part. Remember that you need the JavaScript library for that, otherwise nothing will work. And that's it. I think I use it for maybe a year and a half now. I start with it, put the design up, change all the colors. Of course, not my opinion about the colors, the designer's opinion about the colors, and create the layout, and I just forget about that because it's just there, it just works. It works on mobile phones. If you if we'll check out the website that we have now, if we make it smaller, it will look pretty damn good, okay? Not that it's very complicated UI that I have here, but still, I didn't need even to think about it. It just happened. And you probably, when you have a bigger application, then you will have to really think about that. But Bootstrap helps tremendously in this this aspect. Well, that's it. I hope you had a good time. If you have any questions, please come to me now, afterwards. I'm here for an entire week. You have my details. That's it. This was the wonderful world of Bootstrap. Thank you very much.